Vampires, werewolves, ghouls, ghosts. Mummies that come back to life after 3,000 years. Can such things be? Well, I've spent a lifetime doing my best to persuade you, at least for an hour or two in a darkened theater, that there are things that go bump in the night and raise a lump in your throat, a hard knot of terror. A number of my fellow actors, Bela Lugosi, Peter Lorre, Vincent Price, Miss Elsa Lanchester, to name only a few, have helped me in this persuasion. And in this record, it is my pleasure to share with you memorable passages of dialogue from scenes which film historians have come to regard as classics of terror. Many of the most eloquent moments in these so-called monster movies, of course, were played completely in pantomime. For example, I didn't have a word of dialogue in the original Frankenstein. And my most chilling scene in The Mummy was entirely speechless. The sequence when I, as Imhotep, was reawakening to life after 3,700 years dead in the dust of Egypt. But I hope that some of these excerpts you're about to hear will serve to conjure up visions for you once again of the magic moments of terror in these classic tales. The first great fright film of the talking era was, of course, Dracula. Three sinister syllables forever synonymous with Bela Lugosi. He played the role a thousand times or more on the legitimate stage before transferring it to the screen. And his fame spread from Transylvania, where he was born, to become a household word. Count Dracula, Bela Lugosi, one and the same. A suave, sinister, supernatural figure. His unique voice somehow suited the peculiar intonations and inflections of a prince of darkness, undead 500 years. Hear that magnetic voice again now, as Bela Lugosi speaks to you from the past and introduces himself.
I am Dracula. I bid you welcome. Listen to them, children of the night. What music they make.
The spider spinning his web for the unwary fly. The blood is the light, Mr. Renfield.
I trust you have kept your coming here a secret.
I followed your instructions implicitly.
Excellent, Mr. Renfield. Excellent. I have chartered a ship to take us to England. We will be leaving tomorrow evening. I hope you will find this comfortable.
Thanks. It looks very inviting.
This is very old. I hope you will like it.
Aren't you drinking?
I never drink. Why?
It's delicious.
And now I'll leave you. Good night, Mr. Renfield.
Blood-curdling, I'd say. Author Bram Stoker knew whereof he spoke when he wrote, "The blood is the power." A powerful melodrama of the macabre, Dracula, the vampire film classic of 1931. But the movie makers showed the moviegoers no mercy that year. Their Christmas present was as grisly a story of science gone wrong as was ever put on the screen. In 1818, the immortal book about a man who made a monster was born in the young female brain of one Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley. And over 100 years later, the genius of her imagination was transferred to the medium of the motion picture. I was the misshapen creature in those depression days of 1931 that had to compete with Father Christmas to bring pleasure to people during Yuletide. But somehow it worked. People queued up at box offices all over the country, breaking records. And afterwards, it was evident that millions all over the world felt sympathy for the monster. It was clear from the letters they sent that, while they were terrified by my characterization, at the same time they pitied the monster that I portrayed. And that pleased me because it was exactly what I had hoped. How I came to be built is graphically described in this dramatic scene in which you will hear the voices of three fine actors. Dr. Henry Frankenstein, portrayed by Colin Clive, who died in the late 30s. Dwight Fry, who played in Dracula as well and died in the mid-40s. And Dr. Waldman, played by the late and venerable Edward Van Sloan, who passed away not too long ago in his 82nd year.
The storm will be magnificent. All the electrical secrets of heaven. And this time we're ready. Hey, Fritz? Ready.
Why, what's the matter?
Look!
There's nothing to fear. Look.
No blood, no decay. Just a few stitches. And look. Here's the final touch. The brain you stole, Fritz. Think of it. The brain of a dead man, waiting to live again in a body I made with my own hands. With my own hands.
Dr. Valmon, I learned a great deal from you at the university about the violet ray, the ultraviolet ray, which you said was the highest color in the spectrum. You were wrong. Here in this machinery, I have gone beyond that. I have discovered the great ray that first brought life into the world.
Oh, and your proof?
Tonight you shall have your proof. At first I experimented only with dead animals, and then a human heart, which I kept beating for 3 weeks. But now, I am going to turn that ray on that body and endow it with life.
And you really believe that you can bring life to the dead?
That body is not dead. It has never lived. I created it. I made it with my own hands from the bodies I took from graves, from the gallows, anywhere.
Quite a good scene, isn't it? One man crazy, three very sane spectators.
Thank you. It's alive!
From a creature put together from bits and pieces of dead tissue, as you've just heard, and unfortunately equipped with a criminal brain, I turn next to portraying a terror character for which there was no precedent. Imhotep, an Egyptian priest wrapped in mummy swathes, embedded alive for an offense against the gods. Are ancient curses real? Can they endure through centuries, reach out and affect 20th century's modern superstitions? Played once again by Edward Van Sloan, veteran of Dracula and Frankenstein, the old Egyptologist warned of sacrilege and punishment in these potent words.
Death, eternal punishment, for anyone who opens this casket in the name of Amun-Ra, the king of the gods. Good heavens, what a terrible curse.
Well, let's see what's inside.
Wait! You have read the curse.
We recognize your mastery of the occult sciences, Miller. But I can't permit your beliefs to interfere with my work.
Then why did you send for me this afternoon?
As a friend and an expert. Because I saw this find was unique and I wanted your opinion on it.
It is providential that you did.
Oh, come, Dr. Miller. Surely a few thousand years in the earth would take the mumbo-jumbo off any old curse.
Oh, I cannot speak before a boy. Come out under the stars of Egypt. Do not touch that casket.
But there is always some foolhardy soul who will dare to open a Pandora's box. And when the young anthropologist in the film did, I came to life with this disastrous result for him.
Ah!
What is it?
He went for a little walk. You should have seen his face.
Yes, I went for a little walk. And that year, and in years soon after, in the old dark house, the black cat and the raven, I went for other little walks that somehow always panicked people. And then, in 1935, I met Miss Elsa Lanchester in the scream heard around the world. That was the reaction from Mrs. Lawton when she was introduced to me in
The Bride of Frankenstein.
And that was the voice of the late Ernest Thesiger, playing the peculiar Dr. Pretorius. I found my voice in this sequel and mumbled a few lines. Perhaps you'd like to hear them again.
And now for our lesson. Remember, this is bread. Bread. Mm.
Bread.
And this is wine. To drink.
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 Good. Good.
We are friends, you and I. Friends.
Friends.
Good.
Good.
Before you came, I was all alone. It is bad to be alone.
Alone. Bad. Friend. Good. Friend. Good.
Now come here.
And what is this?
Ah, this is wood for the fire.
Wood.
And this is fire. No, no. Fire is good.
Fire, no good. No.
There is good, and there is bad.
Good. Bad.
But in the end, I decided my reluctant bride and I were better off dead, and told Colin Clive so in no uncertain terms.
I can't leave them, I can't.
Yes, go. You live. Go.
You stay. We belong dead.
I really thought they'd done me in that time. Oh, what an explosion. But 4 years later, they had me back in harness, and I do mean harness. For I assure you, my friends, that makeup was heavy in The Son of Frankenstein. Purists insist that the name Frankenstein refers only to the doctor who created the monster. But it was in this film that the doctor's son himself established the authority for calling the monster Frankenstein when he brooded audibly about the fact that the villagers in the vicinity of his father's laboratory now made his father's name synonymous with his deadly creation. In one part of the picture, the late Lalo Latwell recalls just how deadly.
Most vivid recollection of my life. I was but a child at the time, about the age of your own son, Herr Baron. The monster had escaped and was ravaging the countryside, killing, maiming, terrorizing. One night he burst into our house. My father took a gun and fired at him. But the savage brute sent him crashing to a corner. Then he grabbed me by the arm. One doesn't easily forget, Herr Baron, an arm torn out by the roots.
Bela Lugosi was back in Son of Frankenstein and in a completely off-track role for him. As Igor, the demented blacksmith, he created a characterization which was a great verbal triumph. A far cry from the sinister, albeit highly sophisticated Count Dracula in Human Vampire was the crude, gruff Igor. Listen now to the well-disguised voice of my friend as he describes how he cheated the hangman's noose and lived.
My name is Igor. Let me go, Frankenstein. You'll see that. They hanged me once, Frankenstein. They broke my neck. They said I was dead. They cut me down. They threw me in here long ago. They wouldn't bury me in holy place like churchyard because I stole bodies. They said, so, Igor is dead. You, doctor, Frankenstein, nobody can mend Igor's neck. It's all right.
The boiling sulfur bath that I took at the end of The Son of Frankenstein was hardly a health cure, and it was the last time I ever played my old friend, the monster. But there were other monsters for me and for my friends as well. In 1935, when I was appearing in The Bride of Frankenstein, I remember a very talented New York stage actor was making his debut on the lot in The Werewolf of London. That was Henry Hull, and his portrayal of the lycanthrope was remarkable. But it was The Wolfman of 1941, starring Lon Chaney the Younger, that really established lycanthropes as a genre. As the doomed Larry Talbot, he played a role that would have done credit to his dad. Incidentally, I knew Chaney Sr., the original makeup wizard, a man of a thousand faces. But young Lon never had a chance in The Wolfman. Here's why, in a film quote that's become as classic as, "He meddled with things man was meant to leave alone, or I never drink wine." Even a man who is pure in heart and says his prayers by night may become a wolf when the wolfbane blooms and the autumn moon is bright. And when it was all over for Larry Talbot, when he had fought against werewolfery for the last time and lost, had been killed by a silver-headed cane, his epitaph was spoken by one of the cinema's grand old ladies of the past, Maria Uspenskaya.
The way you walked was thorny, through no fault of your own. But as the rain enters the soil, the river enters the sea. So tears run to a predestined end. Your suffering is over. Now you will find peace for eternity.
And finally, an echo from 1945, when I played Dr. Neiman, disguised as Dr. Lampini in The House of Frankenstein. I'd acquired the skeleton of the infamous Count Dracula in that one. And this is what I had to say on the subject.
No doubt there are some among you who will doubt the truth of what I'm about to say, or doubt the reality of what you're about to see. But believe me, my friends, this is no fake. Before your very eyes is all that remains of a vampire, one of the world's undead. Dare I but remove this stake from where his heart once beat, and he would rise from the grave within which he lies, and turn into a bat, a vampire bat, would feed hideously upon the living whose veins pulsate with warm and vibrant blood. Ladies and gentlemen, the actual skeleton of Count Dracula, the vampire. Furthermore, my friends, one single ray of sunlight falling upon a vampire will destroy him.
And that, my friends, draws to a close my reminiscences and recorded excerpts of highlights from a golden age of Gothic terror, when Frankenstein and Dracula, the Wolfman and Imhotep were young, well, comparatively, and when many great practitioners of the macabre, now gone to their rewards, were enacting roles which earned them undying honors in Fright Film's Hall of Fame. I hope I've engendered a pleasant baker's dozen of shudders in you, reminded you of the rich vein of imaginative lore to be mined from vintage reels of screen tales of terror, and outright frightened you a bit, for that was surely what you wanted, wasn't it? With some of my own weird characterizations and memorable excursions into the strange and eerie by my fellow film prayers in the field of the fearful. And so, until we meet again, may all your nightmares have happy endings in the final reel. Good night, and sleep well.